Guys, I just talked for and did the intro and I wasn't recording, but I just watched Spider-Man No Way Home last night and I slept on it and I woke up and it still doesn't feel real. It was amazing. So before we get into this, you saw the title and everything. If you didn't though, this is a spoiler review. I'm going to be talking about spoilers, so leave if you have anything, you know, if you we don't want to get spoiled. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, let's go. Listen, I'm gonna try not to ramble on too long, keep this video not too long for you guys, but I'm just gonna go down some plot points. So first, like, let's just go through it. I just want to talk about this movie. It was so great. So the plot, let's just go with the plot. So the plot, of course, is from the last movie, Spider-Man Far From Home. Peter Parker's identity has been revealed to the public by our boy Mysterio, and it starts off right after the movie ends, right at the end of that end, that post-credit scene in Far From Home. That's where No Way Home starts off, literally right there, and it's chaotic. It's as soon as it's revealed, the citizen, the people are going crazy. They see MJ, they're like, oh my god, are you Spider-Man's girlfriend, this, that, and the third? It's like literally his life turns around instantly. And a lot of people will say that probably the beginning part is not bad, or like a little, not even slow, just like, you know, compared to everything else, it's not it. Because, you know, later on, you got Doc Ock and Goblin and stuff flying around, but it really did do a very good job of, you know, showing us why Peter ends up going to Doctor Strange. Because if he just ended up going to, if they just started the movie, he gets his identity revealed and he's just like, okay, let me go talk to Doctor Strange. It would just seem very, like, you know, very nasty, like, bad decision type of, like, selfish Peter Parker kind of thing, like, you know. And that just wouldn't seem like his character. But they do a very good way of building up. Like, they start off, the tone is not all happy and jolly like the other movies. It starts off very, you know, like, wow, it's not dark. It's just like a darker tone. Like, it's more serious. It takes itself serious, and I love that. Because the other films, like, it played around a lot, and this one takes itself serious. They know what they're doing. And, like, you can just see how it impacts not only Peter, but the people around him. And that's what really breaks it down. It's not even the fact of, hey, my life is harder, so I want to get Doctor Strange to make everybody forget I'm Spider-Man. It's the people around me, MJ, Ned. They can't get into the college they want to because they know Spider-Man. They're associated with him. Aunt May is going through troubles. They have to all move out. They can't even stay in their own home. They got to move to Happy Hogan's house. It's wild. And then that is Peter's breaking point when they're so excited for college. They all put their applications and they all want to go to MIT. And when they all get the decline letter and it says because of recent, like, you know, media altercations and everything, that breaks him. They all wanted to go, and you can feel for someone his age wanting to do something about that because the people around him, and you can see the Peter Parker in him, and it is great. And then the movie, that's when, you know, Doctor Strange gets involved, then the whole, you know, cool, you know, the multiverse breaks down, and the introduction of Doc Ock was amazing. I love the interactions between all these characters was the best stuff ever. You got Doc Ock, you got all the villains. You see Doc Ock, you see Lizard, you see Goblin, you see Sandman and Electro. All the main villains. You see them all in this movie. And they're all introduced in very, not very early, but like they all play their role. They don't just come into the movie for the final fight and just, you know, fan service. They knew what they were doing with this story. And it's great. And I love the little science, like how all of them are kind of scientists. So some stuff is crazy, like when Doc Ock, he takes Peter's nanotech and puts it on his arms. That was crazy, like, oh, nanotech, you've outdone yourself. Wow, like, That's crazy. And that, and it's a good, also a good way to hinder Doc Ock from just going psycho the whole movie. Because those AI, that his AI wouldn't just... I was wondering when I saw the trailer, like, oh, it looked like Doc Ock was just sitting there. He didn't look like he was in a cage. But looked like he was just sitting there, like, helping them out. And I was really confused, like, huh? But it makes sense now. Because I was like, Doc Ock, I know he's a scientist, but his AI arm would, like, kind of make him go psycho. And everything comes full circle. There's an explanation for, a lot of stuff in this movie. I love it. And then another point I want to bring up is something small. I love that Peter even addresses the whole, yo, Nick Fury was with me. So why don't you just go? I have another, like, I have a good alibi. It's Nick Fury. But they say he's been off planet for a year. So everything was met, like, all the little plot holes, like, not all, of course, not all plot holes, but a lot of important plot holes that were there are filled up in this gap. And, you know, the fighting was crazy. Electro, even Electro, I was wondering, like, Jamie Foxx is normal again? But he starts off the movie blue, like he was in, Amazing Spider-Man 2, and they end up bringing his body back somehow. And, honestly, it wasn't even explained very well, it just kind of happened. But hey, at least you acknowledged it. Like, that, the love in this film, the heart that it has, is crazy. And Green Goblin, dude, they took me back, bro, to 2002. I was like a child then, but they took me back to that first Spider-Man movie that I saw when I was a kid. Green Goblin did his part. It's like, it doesn't even matter. He doesn't even care that this is a different Peter Parker. You see how when Doc Ock is fighting, everybody else, like, their reaction to Tom is like, oh, wait, you're Spider-Man, but you're not our Spider-Man. Like, who are you? Because even Jamie Foxx didn't know who Spider-Man looked like. But Doc Ock, you see his first reaction, you're not Peter Parker. Whoa, hold on. Oh, you're not Peter. Oh, you know. And then Willem Dafoe, his Green Goblin, that evil goblin in him, he doesn't care. Oh, you're Peter? You're not the right Peter? Oh, well. He knows that psychological warfare still. He doesn't care. All he needs is that little piece. He is watching behind the sidelines when Norman is normal, and he's just observing data, and he knows how to strike the heart so well. And it is so good, because Tom Holland Spider-Man, that Peter Parker, needed this challenge. He has not been shown the correct consequences until this movie. This trilogy feels like a big origin story for Spider-Man after this. It was so well done. And when Goblin kills Aunt May, it's just like, every time you see something happen, you're like, she's gonna die. Oh wait, no, she didn't. Oh wait, she's gonna die. And when she tells him, with great power comes great responsibility, and then dies after, it hits so well. And you can now, I can accept that Uncle Ben isn't taken as much seriously in this universe. Because it's a multiverse. Things happen same but similar ways, but not always the same. Maybe Peter wasn't that close to Uncle Ben in this universe. But his Uncle Ben, like the Uncle Ben that we know, the great power comes great responsibility, death, that's Aunt May in this universe, bro. And they do it so well. They do it so well. And by the way, props to Aunt May in this movie, because the first two movies, her role wasn't even that big. This movie, she plays the biggest role, and that is the heart of Peter Parker. She is the one in the first half that keeps him from doing the things that Peter Parker wouldn't do. Like, he has it in him, and she brings it out even more and more and more. And then Goblin even tries to mess with his head, like, oh, you're doing her moral battle right now. And she's like, no, you are not. No, don't listen to nothing. Everything she hears from these people and these guys, she's like, listen, it's just that they did Aunt May so well in this movie, and her death, it was a hard death. It was crazy. And then Tom Holland's Peter Parker, he went through it, and I just love what they did. That was crazy. And of course, we gotta discuss the big kahuna in the room. Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire, are they in the movie? Hell yes, they're in the movie. Oh my god, they did it. When Ned opened that portal And I saw that man in the alleyway. I was like, bro, that's Andrew all the way. Oh my God. And then Toby, the old, I love it. They have Andrew Garfield. They grabbed him, the experienced Andrew Garfield, after Gwen's death and all that, and they grabbed the experienced Peter Parker from Tobey Maguire, the one who has went through all the films, the older Peter Parker, the one who is more wise. You have that. You have the one who can more closely relate to Tom in recent times. Like, oh, Gwen just died. I went on this rampage. Like, I went through what you're going through. I quit being Spider-Man. I stopped pulling my punches. And you have the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man who has aged. He is older. And he is, like, he has had time to reflect on everything that's happened to him. And it's just, he can be that older, wise Peter Parker who knows what's going on. And Andrew Garfield can be the one that can be like, listen, I'm going through what you're going through kind of right now at the same time, you know? And it is great. And I love the interactions between all of them. They did every, I was just always wondering, like, you know, please do a scene where it's like, oh, they're like, oh, Tobey Maguire, his webs are not out of web shooters. They did it. It's great. That scene is great. Oh my God. It's just so good. And I can tell you right now from, I love that a lot of scenes, the tension wasn't broken by a joke or anything. Like, there, of course, there's some, but when Aunt May dies, they take that serious. When the two Peter Parkers are talking to Tom, they take it serious. They don't try to ruin it with a little joke or anything. It is great. From the moment that Aunt May dies until, not even gonna say from the moment, but it was so good. Like, oh my God. That whole, the interaction between the three of them is great. It is awesome. I love it. And I love how they talk to Tom Holland because his Peter Parker is going through it right now. He is in the trenches and they bring him out with open arms. And they're like, listen, we all went through what you went through. And I know you don't want to hear that, but listen, we have a duty. We are good people. We know you're a good person. We know that you don't want to do this, but we cannot let the rage blind you because it will not make you feel better in the end. So we're going to stop you from making the mistakes that we made. It is great. It is fantastic. I love it. I love it. I love it so much. I love it. And I love the role Doc Ock plays. Like, he plays that villain, and then they fix his inhibitor. He kind of turns to a, he goes away into the third act, but he comes back in the third act as a good guy. And I love the interactions between these characters. When the final battle, I love the interactions between Andrew Garfield and Jamie Foxx. Like, oh, this is, oh, you, it's you again. It's my Spider-Man. I love the interaction between Tobey Maguire and Doc Ock, the good Doc Ock. He's now got his head together and he's like, hey Doc, like, how you know, it's just like, this is what these characters were like going to do if the villains didn't go down these routes. These villains were not always just pure villains, you know? And I love how the Tobey Maguire takes on this like spider teacher vibe, like not really teaching him anything, but like morality, like a morality test for him. Like, no, you can't. Like the scene where Tom Holland's about to kill the goblin, he is not playing. He is enraged. I love the fight, by the way. He square triangled that man off the PS4 Spider-Man. He really did him dirty. He did him dirty. But, you know, that is enraged Spider-Man. He's not pulling punches. He's going crazy. He grabs the glider and he's about to impale him with the glider. He's about to be like, you about to die just like you did in your universe. And I love how Tobey Maguire, he has to be that morality test. He catches that glider and he's like, no. No, you won't. You will not. And I love it so much. And he gets stabbed. He doesn't die. That stab was it was obvious. I just really hoped he didn't die, but he didn't. But it was amazing. That movie was so good. It was so great. You can appreciate so much more. The interactions, the fan service, the story was great. Everything was just great. There's so much to talk about. And I just, there's so much to go around and talk about. The movie was a 10 out of 10 for me. You know, of course, no movie's perfect. So if I want to be picky, I'd be like, oh, 9.5 out of 10. But it did what it needed to do. The fan service was great. Ooh, the fan service was great. That's cool. But take that fan service away, and that movie is still great. You can come in that movie. Of course, it's like a capstone to a lot of movies. You need to, you know, see it, all the other ones, to appreciate this one as much. But as a movie, the plot is crazy. The character development for Tom Holland's Peter Parker is amazing. Literally, he goes from Iron Boy. The transition from the Stardust movie from Iron Boy Jr. to Spider-Man is insane. By the way, that ending suit, I need to get a good HD look at it again, but the homage, the oh my god, that suit looks like a tribute to every Spider-Man suit Spider-Man Cinematic Universe suit into one. It feels so good. That movie, it does everything well that you want. That every character wasn't just used for, you know, hey, let's just throw them in a movie and get some cash off of it. They all have their roles. They're not thrown in too late to where it doesn't make an impact. They all have their impact on the movie. It's great. I guess the only two characters that you could say, Sandman did feel like a little out, like, okay. And Lizard had dialogue a lot, but he didn't do a lot of crazy action and everything. But those two were probably the only two they could say anything about. Jamie Foxx, his Electro was done so much better in this. Like, he, the character, like, you could see the, like, how different he is after being a villain and everything. Alfred Molina as Doc Ock, amazing. He did amazing. And the Green Goblin as the main antagonist in this movie did maybe even better than he did 20 years ago, dude. It was amazing. And Andrew Garfield, dude, he is an amazing actor. That man, you can see every time he mentioned Gwen, it broke him. When he had to save Zendaya, that scene was so good. Like, he needed that save. Because Tom Holland couldn't do it, and Andrew Garfield gets right back in the action and saves Zendaya. And it's in the same fashion as if Gwen died, and it's like he breaks down as soon. You feel for it. This movie has so much heart, so much love for it. And they did what they needed to do. MCU Peter Parker is now Spider-Man. He is no longer Iron Boy Jr. He has promoted himself. And the ending, to where he has to make the entire world forget he even exists. That not forget that Peter Parker, Spider-Man. Forget that Peter Parker is even a person in the world. He is a nobody now. He has lost everything he has built up for. The consequences for this movie are there. He has grown. He has learned. He has lost Aunt May. He has lost everything. And he has to fresh start it. And when he goes to see Zendaya or MJ, and he's ready to rekindle everything, he's gonna try to make her remember everything, and he just kind of looks at the cut on her head, and he's just like, man, I don't know if I can put you through that danger again. And he just walks away. Dude, it hurts. Everything hits. I have to clap it up for them, because they did exceptional in this movie. And I just have to say thank you for this. I'm going to have to need to watch it a couple more times. I want to watch it immediately. I just want to watch it again. I just want to watch it over and over. But I'm saying top 3 Spider-Man movies easily right now. And, man, easily. I don't know if it's going to be number 1. Because there's Into the Spider-Verse. Out of the live-action Spider-Man movies, it's up there. And I'm gonna let the hype die down a little bit and see how I feel about it. But that movie was just, it was amazing. I loved it. They did what they needed to do. Peter Parker was, he's evolved, and there's not much more I can say. So if you guys have enjoyed the video, make sure to leave a like for your channel, subscribe, thanks for coming by, and go watch the movie for yourself. Please go watch the movie for yourself and enjoy the greatness it was. Peace out.